and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Phil, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. Over the last few years, wellbeing has risen to the top of the agenda. It's one of the key challenges and also the opportunities that our society faces. In any given week, we actually spend more than a third, well, many of us spend more than a third of our waking hours at work. So it's the place that we most need to get wellbeing right. Our research shows that wellbeing is a key priority for workers too, and 83% say it's up to their employer to facilitate wellbeing in their workplace. And when we think about this issue a little bit more, it actually became more complicated when COVID-19 necessitated the most transformational shift to work for perhaps a century. The most notable was when almost overnight, the office-bound workforce globally relocated to their homes. For the first time in modern history, working from home became the norm. In today's episode, we are going to be talking about how work can be a contributor to our well-being, what the research says about work from home, that trend, how it's growing now and in the future, and practical tips for those who want to prioritise their well-being even while working from home. And joining me today is my wonderful colleague and friend, Sophie Renton. Sophie is a social researcher, she's a sought-after keynote speaker, and she's also the managing director at McCrindle. And additionally, she's also the brains behind a number of our most accessed, publicly available research reports. So she's got a lot of wisdom and insight to share on this topic. And I am delighted to have her as our guest for today's episode. So Sophie, welcome to the Future Report podcast.
Hey Ash, thanks so much for having me. I am so excited to discuss this topic today.
I have been looking forward to having you as a guest ever since we sort of conceptualized this. So it's really exciting, I know, for both of us. And you know, Soph, our team, like many other organizations across the world, have transitioned to working from home over the last 2 years because of various lockdowns due to COVID. And we've come in and out of lockdowns even just recently. We've been in and out of the office. And many of our team have embraced the working from home environment, myself and yourself included, I'm sure. And we've even implemented this working from home way of working into our regular week, even when there's no lockdowns or no restrictions. And it's sort of now built into the culture of our organization. And we've both recently just come out of the 2021 Sydney lockdown, and we're back in the office. We're recording the podcast in the office together without a mask on. So it's really exciting. And I wanted to ask you, so how have you personally found working from home? Have you enjoyed it?
Yeah. Thanks, Ash. I think like everyone, I enjoyed it a lot when we first started, when it was novel and it was new and it was like, oh, yes, I don't have an hour commute anymore. However, over time, the novelty kind of wore off and the, I guess, challenges of working from home and just the missing of our team and the team members and, you know, the water cooler conversations as such, or maybe more correctly in our office is the making coffee conversation that you can step outside of the day and just take a moment to kind of regroup and chat to the people in the office. I think I'm a people person, so I miss that significantly in this time of working from home.
Yeah, I completely agree. We are quite similar, I think, in our personality. We both love people. But yeah, I agree. There was definitely the novelty aspect for me as well at the beginning. I definitely enjoyed it, and I can really empathize with those who maybe have, I think your context really determines that. Maybe people who don't have the great setup at home, or they've got to try and school kids at the same time. Everyone's kind of had their own experience over the last 18 months with COVID and working from home. And what our research has found and what we're going to delve into today is well-being and how we can, as individuals and as leaders, prioritize that when we do work from home. But I wanted to ask you, what is one thing that you've done to look after your own well-being while we have been in this work from home full-time season?
Yeah, I think one of the things I have done is I've been really intentional about those work-life boundaries and tried to be really firm with myself with them. You know, some days are better than others. Sometimes there's just a lot to do and you've got to get it done. But For me, I really like structure. I like routine, and that helps me be the most productive. So, you know, I've got my set time that I'll jump on at the beginning of the day, and I'll try and end it the end of the day, and then close my laptop and walk away from it. And, you know, I don't have my emails or my phone or anything like that. So I've tried to be quite disciplined of my work time is my work time and my rest time is my rest time. Maybe in some ways I've actually missed out on a little bit of the flexibility that work from home can provide doing it that way. But for me, I found that's worked.
Yeah, it's really wise, I think, because when we work from home, our work time can so easily bleed into our rest time. And you're like, oh, I don't have the commute. But then it doesn't really serve your own well-being if you just spend what you would normally spend commuting doing extra work hours. So it can be so 100%. Easy in that work from home environment. And I know for me, I've shared this with you, we both love coffee. I've made that clear on this podcast before. And I do love to go out and buy my coffee. But even that act of driving only just down the road to start my day, buy my coffee, get back, and I'm like, okay, the workday has begun when I walk back in with my coffee in hand and I've had a little bit of social interaction with a mask on with another human being in person, and then sort of sit down and get to work. So yeah, well-being, everyone's kind of got to find, I think, what works for them in this work from home era. And we have done a lot of research over the last 18 months, probably more internally driven research than we've ever done before as an organization, because so much of society and how we work, which is such a big part of our lives, has shifted because of the pandemic. And our research suggests that there are some key benefits and also some key challenges of working from home. Can you elaborate a little on what the research findings said Australians were experiencing with those challenges and benefits when it does come to working from home?
Yeah, it has been such a fascinating time in history to be a social researcher and to observe society during this kind of once in a lifetime event. And you know, we've talked on this podcast before about the catalyst of COVID that has brought about this work from home trend. And you know, with any trend, there are some benefits and there are some challenges. So some of those key benefits of the work from home, which I think we've all experienced, is that time saving. I've already alluded to not having to drive an hour, the less time spent getting ready. I think we've all done the, you know, the top half is presentable, the bottom half is, you know, in the active wear or the comfy. It's you know, what's visible is great, what's not visible, anything goes. The money savings of not having to, you know, pay for that travel or even the lunch, because maybe once again, our pantry is just a little bit too close by in the work from home time. And the flexible working hours have really been what Australians have seen as those key benefits of work from home. But alongside those benefits are those key challenges, which is the biggest one is the social isolation. And I think that comes as no surprise, because in one of our studies, we found that 70% of Australians, like meaningful relationships, are actually developed in the workplace. So if you take out the workplace, we are going to experience that social isolation. And so it's that blurring of work and home boundaries, those missed opportunities for collaboration, and also not setting up our spaces well. Not everyone has the luxury of having that study set up, ready to go. I know for me personally, I've been working from my dining room table, and, you know, that's a different experience altogether, and, you know, relocate to go on the Zoom call and then come back. And so it's not necessarily the idyllic world that we think of work from home, particularly when for so many of us, our work from home actually meant going to work from a cafe. And with the cafes being closed, that has shifted. So, yeah, I think those are some of the challenges for Australians. And I know one that I actually found for me personally during this most recent lockdown was that if I wasn't intentional about leaving the house, there were some days that I didn't even do that. So, you know, at McCrindle, we actually brought in a steps challenge for our team to help kind of prioritise that well-being. And it actually became a bit of fun in that competition to get us to get up, leave our house, and look after our well-being in a time where it could be very easy to just shift from working and being seated to Netflix and being seated and, you know, just that sedentary lifestyle going round and round.
Yeah. And I, so as an employee at McCrindle, really appreciated the steps challenge and just that little bit of extra motivation. We could talk about it in our group chat. We could, you know, talk about it in emails. And I think that's one thing as well for me. I totally agree with our research around the benefits and the challenges. And I've experienced those personally. I was also working on the dining table, which is like the kitchen and the living room and the dining space. I'm like, hey, all of it's blurring into one. Cool. But that's a reality for so many of us. And I think, yeah, just having a little bit more extra purpose or initiatives or fun. And so much of that incidental connection happens when you're in the same place as other people. And it just happens when, like you said, around the water cooler or making a cup of coffee, or someone says a funny joke and we all laugh in the open plan office. Whereas when you're at home, you know, it's very different because you're on your own. And it's, I think, a lot more productivity based around your connection with your colleagues. That's what I found anyway. So yeah, it's been, I think, and it has been and will be vital for leaders and organizations to implement some of those creative ways of getting people up and out of their home office and ways of connecting with their colleagues. So it's certainly important. And I think working from home, you know, the global workforce has adapted to it. We've been forced to do it. Maybe some organizations had reservations about working from home. My question to you, Sophie, is do you think working from home will become an expectation of people who work in the future?
Mm. Well, I guess once we've had a paradigm shift, it's very difficult to go back. And in some ways, the old arguments of people aren't productive at home or it's difficult to communicate have really been proven wrong over the last 24 months by the global workforce, continuing to deliver and bring their outputs at a greater level and in a greater level of change maybe than ever before in history. So I guess those arguments are really no longer valid. So there will be a continuation of working from home into the future, I believe. And I think that actually really does create a tension for leaders around how they encourage that or respond to a workforce where that is an expectation whilst not losing the elements of creativity and collaboration that can really be facilitated well within the office. So it's not necessarily a shift away from the office altogether, but it's just how do we actually get the best of both worlds? How do we utilize our environment well to have the most engaged, productive workforce that we can?
Absolutely. And our research backs this up. You know, we conducted a study last year in the first sort of round of lockdowns that many Australian states and territories experienced. And we asked Australians, because we had this hypothesis as, you know, as thought leaders in this space around, okay, we think work from home is here to stay, but do Australians like it? I remember you and I were working on crafting this survey together and we thought, let's put in a question about what people's ideal way of working is. And we put a few options to them, everyone working from the workplace all the time, everyone working from home all the time, or a hybrid of the two. And overwhelmingly, 62% of employed Australians said it was that hybrid of work from home in the workplace that is their ideal. So I think we want the best of both. We recognize that there's some work that's better suited to the office or the workplace where we can gather with others and we get social connection and we get input and fun and creativity and collaboration. There's also benefits to working from home part-time. So yeah, I think definitely the future is going to be a mix. And what I find really interesting as well is that a lot of leaders that I've spoken to sort of maybe have an assumption that because the emerging generations of workers like millennials and Gen Z particularly are more tech savvy and expect flexibility in their work, that they assume therefore that these younger generations are going to want to be more likely to work from home. But interestingly, our studies have kind of challenged that assumption a little bit. So what have you found from the research? What does that suggest about how different generations have different preferences around working from home?
I think life stage is crucial when we explore the desire to work from home. You know, if there's for Gen Ys and millennials who are parents, working from home when you're not trying to homeschool is actually often really appreciated because they've got greater demands on their time. So having that element of flexibility that they can do the kids drop off and they can come back and then they can, you know, get some work done. They can go pick them up at the, you know, 3:15 or whatever it is, but they've got that ability to be flexible and it's not so much about when they're working, but it's getting the work done. For our younger generation, however, yeah, a lot of people have been like, yeah, they would just love the remote workforce. And there is an element that do, and they really appreciate the flexibility. And I think it comes down to that choice. However, we've often found that with Gen Z, they actually really like being in the office and they love the collaboration and the community and the vibe and the experience. And if I even reflect on our own McCrindle team, it was definitely our Gen Z team that were the ones that were just saying, when is the office open again? I am so excited to get back. You know, I was definitely in that space, but even more so our Gen Z just love working from the office. So I think that's actually maybe a bit of a difference to what people expect on this work from home era, but it's actually almost older generations who maybe are more established in their relationships and less about that community. You know, they still love and value community, but they just want to get their work done where they are and shut off for the end of the day. And it's almost them that are leaning towards the work from home.
Yeah, absolutely. And I was quite surprised too. I maybe held some of those assumptions around younger generations really embracing it. But actually, yeah, the workplace is so important for them because they aren't involved in other community groups as much as maybe older generations are. They are more tech savvy. And so it's almost like a counter trend that they need that in face-to-face interaction that so many of them rely on the actual physical workplace for. So yeah, it was really challenging. So, and again, another lesson to all of us that we need to learn time and time again to not stereotype people of certain ages. But also I think your comment about life stage is really important because yeah, everyone has had a different experience of working from home and COVID-19 just overall around how they found that. And it did, really does depend on your home setup and what's going on. And if, like you said, if you've got kids who are relying on vying for your time and attention while you're trying to maybe work as well. So definitely can be a challenge. And I think the role of the office or the workplace is something else that maybe will change and shift as a result of this changing way that we've worked. And again, you know, our research that I just shared does suggest that people do want to work from home more in the future, at least maybe for some part of their week. But working from home isn't actually always conducive to certain ways of working or certain tasks. Like if you need to collaborate with someone or work together on something, that can be better to do in the same workplace. And I know that you and I have reflected on this even, you know, sometimes, you know, you will be in the open plan office together and I'd be like, hey, Soph, quick question. And you're like, yeah, do it like this, or this is my answer, or yes, no, maybe. Like, hey, great, done. Versus when you're at home, you've got to pick up the phone. You're like, then you've got to evaluate, do I interrupt her day? I don't know what she's doing right now. And so there's different tasks, different ways of working, I think, that lend themselves to the workplace or the office versus work from home. What's your reflection on what sort of work is better suited to being in the same workplace as others versus when you're sort of working at home on your own?
Well, we actually asked Australians this question in one of our studies as researchers. We always love to get that bigger picture. And when we explored it, it probably came as no surprise that elements of the workplace that were and well-being that were better reflected when working remotely was that work-life balance or those flexible working hours or even that deep thinking and reflection time of those moments where you can actually be uninterrupted. And I know for me, there are times that I'll just actually close off my emails and just be like, great, the next 2 hours I am thinking about X and I'm not going to let anything distract me from that. And that's easier to do in a place where, you know, you're not accessible by the, hey, Soph question, you know, although I love answering those all the time. So we've got the remote workplace, but in the workplace, it really is the key elements that are, I guess, built in that environment are building those strong relationships with the colleagues, the relationships with leaders and the collaboration. And so if I reflect on our kind of McCrindle journey of our experience, it is the brainstorming and collaboration and the strategizing that I personally prefer much more in person because you get that energy, the creativity that gets unleashed in the room and you can bounce off ideas a lot easier rather than, you know, the click off mute. Okay, can you guys hear me? Okay, great. I'll jump in with my thought now. You know, we've all jumped in there and it's a bit more stilted on, you know, Zoom or whatever platform that you use. And it's still possible. And I think that that is one thing that we really should take away from this experience, that you can actually still accomplish the work regardless of your location. There are just different locations that can make it easier and maybe even more enjoyable to carry out those activities in.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think what leaders and workplaces and organizations probably need to do maybe moving forward is evaluate what are those maybe context or industry specific ways of working that really lend themselves towards actually being together in the workplace versus working from home, meeting people's changing expectations of how they work. But then also, I think it's probably on the onus of leaders to make the workplace engaging and set up in a way that actually facilitates those unique tasks or collaboration things that make the office or the workplace desirable for people. I think we're going to have to see leaders and organizations now go, okay, if we want people to make the trek in, because now we all know that work from home works in many organizations and contexts, what do we need to change about how the workplace is set up or communicate around what tasks we expect people to be doing on those days they are in the office and change the culture, which we'll touch on in a moment around what actually culture is and how organisations can play into that. But I think it's going to be interesting that long-term change around the role of the actual workplace and how that helps us work.
Yeah, definitely. And I just reflect on some of what we've done at McCrindle as we've come out of this Sydney lockdown and, you know, they're easing back into working from the office, because as a team, we love the office. We love working together. We know that our best work is actually done in collaboration. So, you know, we've done a bit of that staggered start back in of just a couple of days in, and we've really prioritized that is meeting days. They are, you know, really big meeting days now, but it is that moment where we can be in that same room and we can prioritize those activities. And so that's our Monday and our Wednesday. And then it's kind of left, you know, for so many of us, we love Tuesday, because Tuesday is almost, you know, the unspoken rule almost of a no meeting day, and you can just come in and you just get your job done. And then Friday's almost like that as well. It's like, okay, let's just finish what we need to do for the week. And then Thursday's like, oh yeah, if there's a meeting, we'll pop that in there. And, you know, that's kind of a way that we've got a culture of setting up our week to prioritize productivity and also to use the environment to the best of our ability.
Yeah. And again, it's going to take leaders, and it's their responsibility, leaders and organizational leaders, to communicate those expectations to their team. And I think when there is that clear understanding of, okay, these days I can pack with meetings, and then the other days I can get my head down and I can allocate tasks to, you know, change that I think helps the well-being of the team when there is that clear communication around that. And speaking of well-being, I guess at an individual level, you know, prior to the pandemic, we were already facing the challenge as a society, and particularly as an Australian society, of people wanting to prioritise their well-being, I guess just in general. And then the pandemic hit, and there's been lots of opportunities for us to reevaluate those, you know, priorities in our life as everything just got thrown up into sort of a state of flux. But also the challenge of prioritising people's well-being when we gathered in the physical workplace. That was something that was on the hearts and the minds, I think, of many people prior to the pandemic. And this can be an even greater challenge when we do work remotely or work from home from our individual places of residence. And though there are many benefits of working from home, like we've discussed, to the individual, there can also be some challenges too, as you highlighted so well earlier, Soph. So how can we be looking after our well-being when we work from home as individuals?
I think probably one of the biggest things to be aware of in that work from home environment is that whatever our natural tendencies are get amplified. So if we think about an individual, if you're intentional about getting all of your work done every single day and, you know, maximizing every moment, that's going to get amplified. And, you know, I've discussed with many different leaders and people that there's almost been this guilt for some workers of working from home of like, you know, I'm not working in the office, so I must do my best and I must get my hours done and I must actually continue to execute in a way. And, you know, that's not healthy for people's well-being to be living under that kind of pressure. But it's like when we're in the office, you know, your day gets interrupted and you have those different moments. Whereas, you know, I've described it as like, cool, it's just me and my laptop day in, day out. And that's all it is. There might be another person on the screen, but it is that interaction with the screen. So it's being aware as leaders that for our team members, that whatever their natural tendency is, it gets amplified, but also as an individual. So we really need to actually take a moment to reflect and recognize what our own strengths and weaknesses are and almost put in some safeguards to help us with that well-being routine. Is it that at the end of the day, you have like a wind down routine of you go for a walk, or, you know, we took up running in the pandemic and it's slightly reduced. I'll get back into it next week. but, you know, what is it that you do to wind down at the end of the day and you almost leave the door and you re-enter? Because for so many, we had the commute that was your reflection on the day and you could switch off. And then when you pulled into the driveway and you open that door, you're like, okay, I'm ready for the next part of my day. And, you know, we don't have those natural, steps in our day when we're working from home. And so it's like, how do you create that to look after your well-being? And probably one of the other things is that in this work from home time, you alluded to it before, but the Zoom in the virtual world is very transactional. And we need that relational aspect of work, that we are, of course, human beings. We're not human doings. We are, you know, it's a human-centric element of work that actually helps us to do our work better. And I think as a leader, if you're finding that you don't actually have a very engaged workforce, then you need to look at your level of connection, because connection precedes engagement. And if I reflect on our team, we are that really highly collaborative, social, you know, we love each other and we have a lot of fun doing our work together. And, you know, we actually stop and have lunch together every single day. Now, part of that is that we're an open plan office, so it helps just having, you know, that 1 hour of noise, but it also accomplishes so many other things of that human connection and the conversation and, you know, even the Monopoly deal that we play and enjoy. And so we found that during lockdown as a team, we didn't have that anymore. And it was actually one of the things that we really missed as a team. And so as a leadership, we responded to that by, after one of our meetings that we had each week, actually just putting our team into random breakout groups and, having, you know, six or so people in there. And it was just a chance to connect in that relational way. And, you know, did Uber Eats lunch one day for that meeting. And so, you know, everyone's in their meeting and they're like, oh, the door here, like, got to go get my Uber. And, you know, you just got to keep it fun and social as leaders when you're looking after your individual's well-being. But there is a responsibility on the individual as well to know and recognize their boundaries. You know, I can't send anyone home from work when they're working from home because I don't know. So it's growing in your understanding of what your natural tendencies are, building in some safeguards to look after yourself. And as a leadership team, being really intentional about building those connections across the team.
Wow, there was so much gold in that answer. I don't even know what to draw out. I know that as someone who's worked with you for a number of years, that you really do champion that role of well-being and encouraging. And I love what you said around it's the responsibility of the leader, but there's also an onus on the individual, especially when we work from home. So I think that's got to come through both those elements. And as you know, Soph, last year I had the privilege of authoring a book called Work Wellbeing, Leading Thriving Teams in Rapidly Changing Times, which is a book all about the role of work in our lives and how it can be a contributor to our well-being. And you know, you embody so much of what we wrote in the book. And I wanted to read one quote from the book. And if anyone's interested, this is, and for those viewing on YouTube, this is what the book looks like. And there's a website called workwellbeing.com.au that you can find out more about the book there. But one of the quotes we wrote in it is, it turns out that business is ultimately about people. And the people, if well led, deliver superior products, services, and business outcomes. And I think that's the priority shift that we need to get right, that it's people first. That, and I know we have that culture here that we prioritize people. And you do that so well, Soph, as our managing director and our fearless leader. And you know the backstory of this book is that we were actually due to publish this in 2019, but there was some delays for a range of different reasons. And I remember at the time being a little bit frustrated that we had to delay the publication date of the book. And now in hindsight, I'm very grateful that we didn't publish a book about work and well-being prior to the pandemic hitting and changing so much of how we work and prioritizing our focus on well-being. But I wanted to just delve into one area of the book, and we've got a whole chapter called How to Be a Work Wellbeing Champion. And you again, you embody so much of that. You are our work wellbeing champion, and you encourage everyone else to be work wellbeing champions here too. But in the book, we wrote in that chapter about something called the CPI equation, which I know that you believe in and you regularly present on to for our clients and for the keynote presentations that you're booked to deliver. As the managing director of our organization and for our listeners, could you explain what the CPI equation is and why it's important?
I would absolutely love to. It is one of my favorite things to speak about. But just before I do that, I will jump in and say you should definitely read the Work Wellbeing book. What Ash and Mark have written there is amazing and really does help you understand how to really facilitate wellbeing in the workplace and why it's so important, and to give some insight into not just your team, but broader Australian workers' perspectives to be able to build a culture and a workplace that is engaging, that cares about people and is about something bigger so that people really want to be involved in that. So back to your question on the CPI equation, that stands for culture, purpose, and impact. And I guess we really believe that these are three characteristics for organizations that if they get those right, it helps to be that winning combination for a great organization. So the first, which is a C, stands for culture, the P is purpose, and the I is impact. So if we just dig into culture for just one moment, culture can actually be quite difficult to define. And we've kind of said one of the best ways that we can define culture is to think about the image of a tree. So if you think about a tree and you think about almost its fruit and its leaves, that's what we would call the competence or the activities of an organization. It's what's really visible, and it's often what people recognize or know an organization immediately for. It's the activity that people see. The purpose is the trunk, which is the why it exists. It holds up those activities, and then the culture is its roots. It's the how an organization accomplishes what it does. And you can have great outputs and a great reason for existing, but if your culture and your root system is not strong and always getting fresh water, then your organization is actually unlikely to last. So, yeah, we really believe in the power of culture and investing in how things are done within an organization, because it's that experience that matters. It's the seemingly insignificant everyday moments that really build into culture. And as a leader, we need to recognize the little things, because the little things matter much more than we would ever be able to say. That if, you know, there starts to be a culture of being like slightly late to meetings, that actually speaks to something that's so much more. It goes, well, actually, do we recognize why this meeting matters? Do I value my team members' time? Do I think that what I'm doing is actually more important than everything else that this organization is working on and why they've put this meeting on? So, you know, you could just go, oh, they're just late, that's fine. But those little things speak to something so much deeper. So as leaders, we are culture carriers, we are culture enthusiasts, and culture really creates a place that people want to be every day. And as a leader, if you don't want to be at your workplace, then nobody does. So you need to create a place that you want to be. So that's culture. The P is for purpose. So if culture talks about the how, then purpose talks about the why. And from all of our research and our studies, and even just being a human and observing, we know that people want to be involved in something that is so much bigger than themselves. And as you alluded to at the very beginning, you know, a third of our waking hours is spent at work. So people want to invest that time into something that matters. And as leaders, it's absolutely essential to be communicating the purpose of our organization all the time, because that is what gets people engaged and involved. And if I think about McCrindle, you know, I love ours, and it's that we exist to empower human flourishing by promoting truth, wisdom, and beauty. That gets me going in the morning. That helps me go, okay, this is what we're actually trying to accomplish. And we know that we can't have an impact on every single area of society, but we can partner with great organizations that are doing incredible things and help them strengthen their purpose and their impact by giving them, you know, that broader perspective, giving them the evidence and helping them either learn the tools or us doing those tools for them to you know, understand the lay of the land so that they can actually have a greater impact. And then for us, as we partner with them, help them develop their strategic plan or help them understand the trends and how they can respond, I can think of no greater joy than doing that to help create a flourishing society, because we want to build a better society that's flourishing, because as society flourishes, the experience for people flourish and people matter. And that's, yeah, anyway, I can talk about that for a long time. So purpose. And the last of that is impact. And we really need to measure the impact. That's so much easier to say than to do. But when we measure impact, it helps us draw our activity to actually mean something, because we don't want to just do activity for activity's sake. We want everything that we do every single day to take us one step closer to the outcome that we're trying to achieve. So we will always want to celebrate our culture. We want to challenge people in their work. We want to actually for it to be about something that matters with our purpose. And then we want to have a lasting impact and leave a legacy on society and to really pause and celebrate those moments that we get to do that.
Wow. So that was an amazing explanation of the CPI equation. And something I love about it as well is that it's, I think, a really important element of not just attracting great talent as people and employees, but retaining them as well. And also the fact that it's an equation, that all the elements are important. And I think when organizations can prioritize each of them, I think it's actually a really great strategy to avoid, hopefully, people burning out, which is, again, something that can be a real detractor from someone's well-being, especially as it pertains to work. So an amazing overview of that. So thank you so much. And I've got one final question for you. As an experienced researcher, as a leader in and of your own right, you're the managing director at McCrindle. You are our fearless work well-being champion in many ways. What is one piece of advice that you have for leaders who want to prioritize the well-being of their teams moving forward?
Yeah, I loved this question, and trying to think of just one piece of advice was very challenging. But I think probably what I really reflect on is, as a leader, we never want to take our people for granted. You know, our people are what help our organizations get where they need to go. And we really want to, encourage people to love, appreciate, and value your team as people, not as just a whole collective, but as individuals as well. And, you know, there's an African proverb that I love, and it says, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. And I think when we recognize that actually the massive purpose and impact that we want to have, we can't actually accomplish on our own as a leader. As a leader, you're not the best at trying to get everything done. But as a leader, our job is really to solve the problems and equip our team and our leaders to thrive. Because as every person on our team begins to think like a leader, begins to rise and to see the challenges, the opportunities, but knows the vision so clearly, they can really rise to the occasion, their engagement goes up, and they can really contribute to something of value together. So, yeah, it's about being holistic. It's about being aware of people's world that's happening outside the workplace, because people, they don't just turn off when they come into the workplace. Their challenges come with them. And yes, we're not counselors, and it's not necessarily our role to help them get all of their life together, but how do we coach people through that? How do we go, it's actually okay. We recognize that you are a human with all of your facets of your world, and there will be days that you'll be better and days that you won't be so great. But actually, we believe in you and we encourage you, and we know that what you contribute to this team really matters. And so as leaders, we have that great opportunity to be the cheerleader, to see something in someone that maybe they don't see for themselves, and to create those opportunities for them to step into those. And then at the end of the day, step back and just go, oh my goodness, that is the greatest privilege of life, to see someone go further than they thought they could have ever gone.
Wow. You've just, again, so eloquently described the fantastic, amazing privilege it is, I think, to be a leader. And that's something I think our organization really values, and what we tried to communicate in the Work Wellbeing book was that, you know, yes, leaders have a responsibility to report on finance and strategy, but they also, the term leadership is really about other people and leading others into a space, like you said, that they may not have actually known they could go. And when you believe and you encourage and you equip and you entrust someone with opportunities that stretch them, that grow them, that can actually contribute to their well-being. And that's how work can play a really important part in our personal well-being. So incredible insights from you today, Soph. I have loved having you as a guest on the podcast. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Ash. And I am so excited to come back again soon.
Oh, me too. Sophie will definitely be returning as a guest, people. So don't fret. She will definitely be back with her wisdom and her insight. And if anyone is interested in finding out more about the Work Wellbeing book or some of the insights that Sophie and I shared today, you can head to a website, as I've mentioned earlier in the podcast, called workwellbeing.com.au to find out more. And as I said, looking, as I say every week, looking ahead, we're excited, and I'm excited because we've got some great episodes, some really interesting, engaging, fun topics coming up, new research, new insights, and I'm excited to get into it. So for more insights about the future, you can subscribe to our podcast, watch the video recording on YouTube, visit McCrindle.com.au, or follow us on socials. Thanks for listening. Bye for now.